Friends, good morning. Whether you're watching this on Sunday morning or at some other time of the week, I want to welcome you into this spiritual sanctuary. My name is Nathan Dannison. I'm one of the pastors of the First Congregational Church in Kalamazoo. We're a member church in the United Church of Christ, and every Sunday we affirm that no matter who you are and no matter where you are on life's journey, you are welcome here. Friends, I want to remind you to please fill out the connection card that you've got in your digital bulletin. If you ever need any help with anything, just reach out to us at the church and we'll help get things sorted out. I want us to begin today with a spirit and energy of peace. Take a moment to ground yourself, to get comfortable, to open your heart to the presence of the Holy Spirit that surrounds us all and a love that is beyond human understanding. Open ourselves to the Spirit that intercedes with sighs too deep for human words. And know that in the midst of all of our troubles or our joys, God is right there celebrating with us. So to you I say, may the peace of Christ be with you.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Dann Sytsma, and I'll be the liturgist this morning. And you've caught me on a good day. I'm wearing a collared shirt, so we're all pretty lucky. Please join me in the call to worship. When the shouts of anger and hostility pound upon our ears, quiet our hearts as we listen for your voice. When the arrogance of the world threatens to destroy your creation, help us be strong in our service of justice, hope, and peace. O God, hear us as we lift our songs of praise to you.
Great is thy faithfulness, O God, my Father. There is no shadow of turning with thee. Thou changest not thy compassions, they fail not. As thou hast been, thou forever will be. Great is thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have need, great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me. Summer and winter, springtime and harvest, sun, moon, and stars in their courses. Join with all nature in manifold witness to thy great faithfulness, mercy, and love. Great is thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, thy hand hath provided. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord. Thank you. peace that endureth, thine own dear presence to cheer and to guide. Strength for today and bright hope for tomorrow. Blessings all mine with 10,000 beside. Great is thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me. Great is thy faithfulness, O God, my Father.
Friends, we are a congregation that is dedicated to the way of Jesus Christ. And in everything that we do, we try to model His faith, His behavior, His teachings. And so, to that end, we are also a public sanctuary church. We provide sanctuary for Auntie Sahida Nadim, who has lived with us for 2 years now on our campus. And every Sunday, we pray a special prayer together. It's the prayer of sanctuary. It's for Sahida, but it is also for all those who are hurting, who need hope, and who need protection. And so I invite you now to please pray our prayer of sanctuary with me. God, eternal refuge, we humbly ask that you protect your precious daughter, Sahida Nadim, in her time of struggle. Protect her from those who seek to do her harm. Give her strength and courage during the day and rest and peace during the night. Strengthen the spirit of all your children in the community of Kalamazoo. Make them one people for the sake of the poor, the wanderer, the immigrant, and all those seeking refuge in this difficult day. Amen.
Happy Sunday, everyone. This is Pastor Sarah with a message for the kids. I wonder, have you ever planned a party and been really looking forward to it, but then when the party actually happens, something goes wrong and it's not the way that you wanted it to be? It can be really disappointing. I remember from when I was a kid that sometimes the days that I was most excited about were also the times when I would feel the biggest disappointment if things didn't go the way that I wanted them to. Actually, I think that's still true even now that I'm a grown-up. What do we do with that kind of disappointment? And what do we do if we feel like we've disappointed someone else? Those are some of the things that are going to come up in our scripture reading for this morning. Sometimes people assume that they know who these different characters in this story are. Sometimes they decide that the person who's planning the party must be God. Or they decide that the guests who didn't come must be those people that I disagree with. I think that we all have to be really careful when we listen to parables like this one. And we need to be open to recognizing ourselves, even in places that feel a little bit uncomfortable. Are you ready for today's blessing? Okay. Dear God, help us be patient and forgiving. Help us deal with disappointment and look for possibilities. Amen. I hope you guys are all doing well. Have a happy October.
Scripture reading this morning is from Matthew chapter 22, verses 1 through 14. As always, I'll be reading from the Inclusive Bible. Then Jesus spoke to them in parables. He said, "The kingdom of heaven is like this. There was a ruler who prepared a feast for the wedding of the family's heir. But when the ruler sent out workers to summon the invited guests, they wouldn't come. The ruler sent other workers, telling them to say to the guests, 'I have prepared this feast for you. My oxen and fatted cattle have been slaughtered, and everything is ready. Come to the wedding.' But they took no notice. One went off to his farm, another to her business, and the rest seized the workers, attacked them brutally, and killed them. The ruler was furious and dispatched troops who destroyed those murderers and burned their town. Then the ruler said to the workers, 'The wedding feast is ready, but the guests I invited don't deserve the honor. Go out to the crossroads in the town and invite everyone you can find.' The workers went out into the streets and collected everyone they met, good and bad alike, until the hall was filled with guests. The ruler, however, came in to see the company at the table and noticed one guest who was not dressed for a wedding. 'My friend,' said the ruler, 'why are you here without a wedding garment?' But the guest was silent. Then the ruler said to the attendants, 'Bind this guest hand and foot and throw the individual out into the darkness, where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. Many are called, but few are chosen.'" Hear what the Spirit of God is saying to the church. Thanks be to God.
Kinfolk, happy Sunday. Kindred, let us pray. Almighty and sovereign God, we lay our hearts upon the altar of your grace again. Behold your little flock, scattered yet whole. We're ready to receive you today, Lord. Amen. So here in Kalamazoo, we've got this little perfunctory prayer that we do every couple weeks before the city commission meeting. And I get tapped to do this little ritual a few times a year. It's called an invocation. It's a little simpler these days because we can do it wherever we're at. But a different clergy person performs the invocation at each meeting. And these days it's all done over Zoom, of course. We're all getting quite good at praying over Zoom. And God's probably getting a little bit worn out on Zoom prayers, but they seem to work just fine. And surely in a more perfect world, I think there would also be an atheist, or at least some kind of secular humanist in that rotation of clergy. We don't really have that right now, but that's okay. It's a little thing, the invocation, a small thing. I mean, it's supposed to be a little thing. It's supposed to happen quickly. Mine's happen, they happen quickly. I'm sure that some of my peers wax a bit more sermonic during their invocations. They don't really give you a time limit like they do with public comment. I think sometimes I get invited to do a lot of invocations because I am brief. As soon as you say the word, though, as soon as you're done, you say amen. They don't really, you say amen, and then everybody turns and pivots, and their eyes shift over to, up from their dress shoes and across towards Old Glory flag, and the right hand releases the left from the pious embrace of the prayerful, and it covers their heart, and then they speak the words, right? The Pledge of Allegiance to the flag of the United States of America. That's the real ritual, I think, because it represents that the real power that is present in that chamber, at least when they're actually able to meet in the chamber. When you pledge your allegiance to something, you're taking your life in your hands, literally. That's why we cover our heart. The word allegiance comes from Middle English. It means a man who belongs to his liege lord. Liege lord. This is bending the knee before your sovereign, pledging your sword and the swords of your household to his battle standard. Knights would remove their helmets while pledging their allegiance so that their face could be seen and recognized by their sovereign. And that's why today we remove our hats when we make the Pledge of Allegiance. To pledge allegiance to the flag of America is to make a verbal commitment to one's own willingness to die in service to that flag. And sometimes we make children say it, which I think is a little bit crazy. But we all of us, I guess, serve several masters, I suppose. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands. Allegiance to the flag is allegiance to the republic. This is superior to pledging to a king, I think, definitely. A republic above any leader, and above the republic, of course, stands a document, the United States Constitution. And so taken literally, what's happening at these city commission meetings is this. First, you know, Mayor Anderson bangs a gavel. Second, some random citizen performs a little religious ceremony that's specific to their tribe or whatever, and then everyone turns and recites out loud an oath to die in service to the republic. And then they get down to the important business of public transit millages and wastewater treatment contracts and whatnot. So, okay. I want to be clear right out of the gate here. I don't have any specific antipathy toward the Pledge of Allegiance. I think it was well written originally before they changed it. I think it was well written, and it was written incidentally by a Baptist minister who was a socialist. If anything, I think the pledge, like many things in life, should be treated with much greater reverence than we treat it. I want us to think more seriously about where we place our own personal allegiances, our loyalties. Who are we loyal to? What are we loyal to? Is it a person? Is it a document? Is it an idea? And why? So today, Jesus shared this parable with us, and it's a hard one. This is a hard one to talk about. Dann did a marvelous job reading it, but this is in a certain sense, it's terrible. And I don't mean terrible as in it's bad or painful or mean-spirited. I mean terrible in the more archaic sense of the word, as in something that is going to inspire in us a measure of terror, something we should take extremely seriously. He has to tell us this thing. It's the parable of the wedding feast. It's a hard one. Kingdom of heaven is like this. There was a ruler who prepared a feast for the wedding of the family's heir. When the ruler sent out workers to summon the guests, they wouldn't come. And this goes on. The ruler, the king, sends out his servants again, and people attack the servants of the king. Now, obviously, these people do not have any allegiance toward this particular king. And then he invites random strangers to the feast. They come in from the street, but then, a parable within a parable, one of the guests didn't even bother to change his clothes before he came to the banquet. And he's cast out. At the heart of the matter here is that the people have no allegiance to the ruler in this parable. He's treated with disrespect. People fail to serve their master. Well, who is my master? And when Jesus comes to me and I'm called and called and called, whose allegiance is going to be on my lips? Is Jesus Christ my Lord and Master? Is he? Does all power and authority rest upon him? It's long after I've been called and called and called again to come to the wedding feast. The kingdom of God, where God alone is the master. God is calling and calling, sending invitation after invitation after invitation to the banquet. Do I ignore the call? Do I reject the call and attack the messengers who sent it? Do I attend, but, you know, sort of dressed in my sweatpants like I'm getting ready for a Zoom call? Lackluster and tepid attitude? That last one, I think, personally, for me, is the difference between cheap grace and costly grace, to borrow from Bonhoeffer. Cheap grace is just showing up. I think it matters. I think it matters that we suss out our allegiances and figure out who our master is. It matters today. It matters because life is too short to waste on lackluster praise and lukewarm faith. Now, I know I'm going to die someday. You don't go very long in my line of work without coming to terms with that cheerful little detail. That'll be my apocalypse revelation of Nathan when the world ends. For me, at least, that'll be the apocalypse. As far as I'm concerned, from my perspective, that will be the end of the world. And if all of my allegiances, of all of them, of all the pledges that I've made in my life, are only in and of this world, what will I have gained? And what of the destination of my eternal soul? When my master arrives at the door of my tomb and knocks, will I be ready to receive that invitation? If I've never responded to the invitation in my life, will I suddenly spring up to respond? Or in the words of Rob Bell, if someone never desired a relationship with God in this life, why would they want one in the next? That's what troubles me. In our present age, we've permitted our mortal allegiances to rise to the level of religious engagement. You see the way that people talk about the government on the issue of taxation or something like that arises. They elevate government to the same seat as God. They say, oh, that sort of thing is not God's responsibility. It's the government's responsibility, or the government's responsibility is not the responsibility of the Christian. We've permitted mortal allegiances to rise above their station. And if you doubt me, I refer you to social media. Or at least, you know, as much as you can stand. Everybody worships something today. And I'm especially afraid because we've permitted our religious allegiances, our faith, to become tepid and lukewarm and compartmentalized while allowing our other allegiances to run rampant. Church has been relegated to this small little place in our life together. We treat faith with suspicion and religions in decline. I'm afraid that our faith disciplines and practices grow thin at the expense of our other affiliations, especially in these riotously political seasons where we make allegiances, not even to the Constitution or the flag, and not even to policies or platforms, but to individual politicians. Our competing allegiances will not redeem us from the grave. There's only one allegiance that can do that. There's only one God. And however you know God, whether it's through Jesus Christ or some other pathway to God, some other allegiance, some other tradition, in my mind, that is the nexus of power and authority in the domain of the human experience. And so for my allegiances, what I've done, you can do this if you wish, I've appended to the end of each and every one of them the following five words: because I serve Jesus Christ. First and last. After a lot of thought and prayer and reflection, I do allege myself to the flag of the United States that represents our republic. And if I was called upon to die in service to my country, I would do so, because that's the value of my allegiance. But this is because I serve Jesus Christ. And I will celebrate and cherish my neighbor because I serve Jesus Christ. And I allege myself that I will act a certain way and protest a certain way and live a certain way and give money a certain way and love a certain way and march a certain way because I serve Jesus Christ. And all of my allegiances, all of them, from my nation to my city to my church to my family to all of these earthly allegiances, will fall beneath my final and ultimate allegiance to the master of my life, the master whom I serve in life and death, who is Jesus Christ. And if any one of these earthly allegiances should cause me to abandon my allegiance to God, then I've lost my way. Because only one of these allegiances will matter at all when the messenger comes knocking at the door of my life the final time with an invitation in hand. Only one. Now, Jesus also teaches us, do not fear, little flock, for it is God's good pleasure to show you the kingdom. And a lot of us have already seen it. We've been there. We know it's a good place to be. We've smelled the lilies growing in the meadow gardens. We've heard the bird song and the aroma. We've smelled the aroma of the food and heard the laughter of the guests and seen the children playing. We've stood holding a stranger's hand and turned to them and said with all honesty, I love you. I love you. And we've seen with the eyes of children. That's what we get from the kingdom. That's what's held in store for us at the wedding banquet. Anyone would not want to come because of some other allegiance. It's not worth it. Our allegiance to Jesus Christ does not have to be loud, intolerant, aggressive, mean-spirited, boastful, or narrow-minded. And in case you missed it, your allegiance to your Creator doesn't need to simply take the form of the way of Jesus Christ to be good and true and holy. A shepherd knows his sheep. But while I may pledge allegiance and I may pledge my life to defend many people and places and ideas within this world, I do these things because I serve Jesus Christ. And though I will die, that is all I will do on behalf of death. And every allegiance I've ever made will vanish, except for one. Except for one. For the power and the glory and the honor are His forever and ever. Amen.
Let us join together in the prayer for our church.
Lord, we gather this day to receive the gifts that are given to transform our lives from that of isolation to joyful service. We have come from various struggles and times of confusion, seeking restoration and healing. You remind us of the blessings of healing love for all people represented in this community of faith and love. As we offer prayers for many people in situations near and dear to us, help us also remember that we are in prayer for ourselves, for strengthening, healing, encouragement, and peace. Give us spirits of confidence in your presence that we might be part of the great healing and justice ministries you have set before us. These things we ask in Jesus' name. And now let us pray as Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And do not let us fall into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
The other day I was sharing with my child the fable of the ant and the grasshopper. And it's a seasonally appropriate tale as we head into the autumn season, as the wind blows colder and we prepare for what we know is coming, a season where we must give. And so I ask that you would bring the full tithe into the storehouse. Please visit fccgiving.org and give generously to support the work of the church's Deacons Fund. This past week, we've purchased car seats for those in need and made several vehicle repairs. For whatever reason, that seems to be an important ministry right now to get essential workers back to work. We're also assisting people to stay in their homes. We've assisted with fuel for transportation to and from work. And we're getting ready to launch an exciting new partnership with the county to provide some stable housing for the winter, to ensure that there is no one who sleeps rough on the streets of Kalamazoo because they have no place else to go. So please give to the church generously and help us bring in the full tithe to God's own storehouse. Please give generously. Thank you. These are difficult days, but days in which we can still choose daily to live deeper in the way of Jesus Christ, to be sown into the world like good seed, or to be pressed down into the bread of the world like leavening, to be a light set upon a hill that can be seen for others, or to just simply do the quiet work of mercy and justice, and to do so humbly, walking beside God. Whatever you have coming this week in your life, remember that you are not alone, that you are deeply and unconditionally loved by God who created you, who is right there beside you, and who longs for your prayers and for your love. Kinfolk, go forth in peace to love and serve the Lord your God. Amen.